All around the world, wind and solar power plants are multiplying, clear signs of the energy transition. But for it to succeed, one key question remains. How do we store electricity? One option is in liquids. So how does that work? Can this technology compete? And why is China ahead? In late December 2024, Germany was blanketed by thick clouds with barely a breath of wind, a situation known as the dark doldrums. For renewable energy, it's a huge challenge. Under these conditions, solar and wind farms produce only a fraction of their usual output. The result is energy shortages and rising electricity prices. To balance these fluctuations, large-scale energy storage is essential, and that's where battery technology comes in. By 2050, more than 1,000 gigawatts of electricity will need to be stored safely if current energy policies continue. And if countries stick to their CO2 reduction pledges, demand for storage could nearly double. Market researchers estimate that within just 7 years, the global energy storage market could be worth more than $230 billion. But which technology can meet that demand? Right now, lithium-ion batteries dominate, the same kind used in electric cars. But they rely on raw materials like cobalt and nickel, which are often mined under conditions that violate human rights. And there's another concern, safety. The internet is full of dramatic images of burning car batteries. Fires caused by overheating, short circuits, or defects are rare, but in large-scale storage, they could be devastating. In January 2025, a major energy storage facility in California caught fire. Due to ongoing chemical reactions, the blaze couldn't be extinguished for days. A new technology is safer, redox flow, although technically it's not that new.
That originally came about in the 1970s with a U.S. patent from NASA.
Claudia Weidlich has been researching redox flow batteries for more than a decade. But first, a quick refresher. In school, we learned that a battery has two electrodes, usually metal. When electricity is needed, electrons flow from one side to the other. A redox flow battery works in much the same way, but here the energy is carried by liquids. The theory, she says, is easy to grasp.
In principle, the battery consists of liquids that can be charged and discharged with the help of an electric current.
These liquids contain an active material dissolved in water. The most widely used version relies on the heavy metal, vanadium, which stores electricity electrochemically. Vanadium ions move back and forth between the positive and negative sides. The energy itself is stored in external tanks. And here's the big advantage. If you need more storage, you just build bigger tanks.
The two liquids are in separate tanks and then pumped through the electrochemical cell. Inside, they basically only come into contact with each other across a membrane, and then can be charged or discharged at the electrodes that are also contained in the cell.
Complex electrochemistry with practical benefits.
One major advantage is that the capacity and performance of the battery can be scaled independently.
Say you need a battery that delivers a lot of electricity at once to cover demand spikes. You just connect more blocks of cells. If the goal is to store large amounts of electricity from, say, a wind farm, you simply expand the tanks. A redox flow battery can be tailored to its purpose. Plus, the liquid isn't flammable, and it doesn't degrade over time. How long a redox flow battery lasts depends on its hardware, the tanks, pumps, and cells. They're best suited for stationary, large-scale storage, like this solar installation on the Spanish island of Mallorca. For now, lithium-ion batteries still dominate, but analysts see potential in redox flow technology. From just under $400 million today, the global market could grow to $1.3 billion by 2030. Even in Latin America, where the technology is still relatively unknown, experts are watching its development closely.
Redox technology is now being considered as an alternative for integrating storage in the power grids of the Americas, Latin America, and the Caribbean, as an alternative to lithium-ion batteries.
Alfonso Blanco is a director at the Inter-American Dialogue, a think tank and policy forum. In his work, he looks at which storage technologies policymakers might support. Often those choices depend on a region's natural resources.
Latin America is clearly one of the regions with the greatest potential for lithium production and supply worldwide. But refining is another story. That part of the supply chain is heavily concentrated in China, and that creates dependency within the production chain. In this regard, with respect to China, I personally believe that redox technology offers a greater degree of freedom.
But there's a challenge: investment costs. Lithium-ion batteries are well established, and falling lithium prices make them far cheaper than vanadium redox flow systems. But that's not the only consideration.
With a lithium battery, the cost is currently much lower per kilowatt hour. But once they're worn out or defective, you basically have to throw the whole thing away. With the vanadium flow battery, even if it fails, you can still reuse the electrolyte, the energy-carrying liquid. So really, it's like comparing apples and oranges.
Definitely, flow batteries are more expensive. I would say they are currently twice as expensive.
Jens Nowak, who works at universities in Australia and at Germany's Fraunhofer Institute, stresses that it's not just about the upfront costs.
The real cost, what you normally calculate, would be the cost over the lifetime. You know? And there is then an advantage of these batteries because they have twice as high lifetime.
Still, there are no long-term examples yet. The systems are too new. The Fraunhofer Institute recently launched its pilot project Redox Wind. Its goal is to prove that renewable energy can reliably replace fossil fuels.
So a big wind turbine today has around 2 megawatt. So you can store the energy of a big wind turbine for around 10 hours. Now this sounds not too much, but this is at the end the need for a village. Now, so you can buffer for a village now when there's no wind blowing there for over 10 hours.
But when it comes to energy storage, China is ahead because of its enormous energy demand. Last year, it consumed nearly 10,000 terawatt hours, about twice as much as the U.S.
They simply took everything what they could take in energy sources, and therefore they also need storage. And they discovered really early in the 90s even that flow batteries would be also an option.
The largest redox flow systems are in China. This one, in Dalian, can cover the energy needs of more than 100,000 households. It was built by a Chinese company.
They established some companies there and also built relatively early via governmental support industry. And now they are, let's say, economically advanced. I'm not sure if they are really technology advanced. I would say not really, but currently regarding installation, they are definitely advanced to this.
The market leader is also Chinese, Ronka Power, which dominates by a wide margin. Germany, by contrast, isn't among the front runners.
I don't think the Germans did anything wrong.
Yutong Zhu prefers to speak German. He came to the former communist East Germany 40 years ago as an elite student from China. He sees a big difference in mentality between the two countries.
Here in Germany, my colleagues are very conscientious in their work in research and development. They're meticulous and want to avoid even minor problems or mistakes. That's why they take quite a lot of time. In China, it's all about speed. If they see an opportunity, they say, all right, let's take the risk. Let's try it out and then improve it through practice. That's a key difference.
Today, Yutong Zhu is managing director of Jena Flow Batteries. Since 2023, the company has been owned by a Chinese parent firm. Suqian Time Energy Storage Technology acquired Jena Batteries after the startup ran out of money. But the original founder isn't bitter. His idea is now being realized on a much larger scale.
As a chemist and inventor, it's fantastic to watch an invention move into technology and large-scale production.
His invention is a new organic material that can replace vanadium in a redox flow battery.
The big advantage of organic storage materials is that they can be produced from very basic raw materials in almost any chemical factory. They don't rely on special mines or rare resources. Instead, they can be made from simple substances like acetone and ammonia, which are already produced worldwide in large quantities. That makes the technology independent of critical raw materials and complex supply chains.
That matters because vanadium makes business tougher as its price swings sharply. The EU has even labeled it a critical raw material, meaning it could suddenly become scarce and expensive. Alternative storage liquids could help boost both sales and production of redox flow batteries.
This is also part of our parent company's globalization strategy. Once the market is established, we plan to expand production worldwide, in China, in Europe, and possibly in the US.
For now, the Chinese site is expanding, with a target of 5 gigawatt hours by late 2026. The inventor is confident.
In 10 years, this company will be one of the market leaders in stationary energy storage with redox flow batteries, with many, many gigawatt hours of installed redox flow capacity across Europe and beyond.
Redox flow batteries are flexible, long-lasting, and safer than lithium-ion batteries. But they're also less proven and more expensive. Whether they break through depends on lowering costs and on how the global trade conflict unfolds. One thing is certain. To replace fossil fuels, solar and wind must deliver electricity to the grid in all weather conditions. And that's only possible with large, reliable storage systems. So what do you think? Will battery technology advance enough for solar and wind to truly replace fossil fuels?